with me a lady who is far more experienced on the diversity topic than I am, and I'm very excited to hear from her. Margaret Heffernan has written many books tackling women in business, competition and strategy. And I think she's going to talk to us about why difference matters in the way that we make decisions. Thank you, Margaret.
Right, thank you. In about 2008, I was commissioned by the BBC to write two plays about Enron. I think because I was the only playwright they could think of who could actually read a balance sheet, might understand what the heck had been going on. And let's be honest, it was pretty hard to understand what had been going on. Anyway, I read the transcript of the trial of Jeff Skilling and Ken Lay. And at the end of that trial, the judge, Simeon Lake, summed up with a reference to willful blindness, a legal concept that says if there are things you could have known and should have known and somehow managed not to know, the law deems that you have been willfully blind. Your ignorance was a choice. And I remember reading this and thinking about the companies I'd run myself, and a chill kind of ran down my spine because I knew there were circumstances in which there was information that I could have known and should have known and didn't know. And I thought it was an incredibly high standard. But then the bank started to collapse, and everybody was saying, oh my goodness, we had no idea. And this idea of willful blindness came back with a vengeance. And it was then that I decided to try to figure out, well, how does this happen? If it happens in Enron, if it happens with banks, I could think of other circumstances. The Catholic Church in Ireland, a great deal of history. If willful blindness was so pervasive, how did it happen, how did it work, and could we understand better how to counteract it? And since I wrote the book, of course, we've seen epic examples of willful blindness. We've seen it in phone hacking. We've seen it in Rotherham. We've seen it in Mid-Staffordshire. We've seen it at Wells Fargo. We've seen it at BP. We've seen it at General Motors. It's as though not a month goes by without a major institutional failing following exactly the same narrative. And this is how it goes. Something goes wrong and everybody says, oh my goodness, we could never have seen that. And then they decide it was a couple of bad apples. And then investigations show that actually quite a lot of people knew that there was something wrong. And then it turns out that actually everybody knew that there was a lot going wrong. And then you have all kinds of restructuring and re-engineering and all kinds of promises about how now everything is going to be different. And in all of the institutions that I've studied where this has happened, that trajectory plays out pretty relentlessly. And there are a couple of key causes. You know, as I unpeeled the onion of willful blindness, certain patterns recurred over and over again. People are obedient. They will do what you ask them to do, even if it's wildly unethical. They are conformists. They'll stick with the crowd because we're social creatures and we don't want to be isolated. But one of the really key themes that emerged from my research was around homogeneity. What happens when you have lots of people who are the same? And what was really clear in all of these instances was you had a lot of like-minded people with a lot of similar backgrounds and a lot of the same outlooks, seeing the same things and corroborating the same decisions. And so I became interested in this and into how this really works, because I don't really buy the idea that these are just bad people. And so I started investigating the neurobiology that allows us to do this. And it's kind of an interesting story. So what happens is this. All of our brains have too much information to deal with. This is not a new phenomenon. It's a general phenomenon about the information we receive all day long. And so our brains have evolved over millennia a fantastic load balancing mechanism. So what your brain is doing every time it experiences any piece of information is it's asking a very simple question, which is, have I seen this before? Because if I've seen it before, I don't need to process it. And my processing capacity, my cognitive capability, is being reserved for genuinely new stuff. So I spend my life in airports. I don't tend to research the airports before I land in them because I think actually most airports are roughly the same. I'm saving my cognitive capacity for the genuinely new stuff, the new people or the new place. So this is brilliantly efficient. There's a problem, however, there's a real catch here, which is essentially what I'm doing is I'm speeding through information about anything that's familiar. And what's most familiar to me is me. I'm the voice that I hear all day long. Mine is the face that I see in the mirror every morning. And so when I encounter somebody like me, I feel a very high degree of comfort. Several years ago, I was actually in this building speaking at my first TED conference, and I encountered a woman who, like me, had a background in media, like me, had lived and worked both in the US and the UK, like me, had strawberry blonde hair, and like me, had a daughter named Lily. And sure enough, within a few seconds, we were each other's best friends, and I was pretty convinced that her Lily was nearly as brilliant as my Lily. This is the biological basis of bias. And what it means is we are all biased. We can't help it. The neurobiology of bias bestows enormous rewards. You couldn't take it apart, and you couldn't function if you did take it apart. But it also, of course, represents a risk when it comes to decision making, because it means I am overwhelmingly likely to surround myself with people who are like me, who think like me, who will compound my bias, and as a consequence, compound the risk implicit in my decision making. It means that it's highly unlikely that I will choose to surround myself with people who are wildly different and highly likely to disagree. In addition, there's much in the way that we organize our institutions that compounds that bias. And of these, probably the most extraordinary and I think concerning is a feature known as organizational silence. And this comes from some research done by New York University researchers who interviewed a whole cross-section of executives and said, do you have interest in issues at work that you don't voice? And 85% of them said yes. Now, 85% is a very high number. It means that we hire people, smart people, we bring them into our organizations, and mostly they don't say what's on their mind. I would argue that the combination of homogeneity and organizational silence lies at the heart of willful blindness. It means that we hire people who pretty much see what we see, and if they disagree, they're very unlikely to say anything about it. Now, the reason we do teamwork, of course, is that we hope and believe that that's a fantastic antidote to both of those problems. But the problem with teamwork is how do you really get the best out of lots of people working together? I'm sure everybody in this room has had the experience where some teams have been absolutely fantastic, really mind-stretching, challenging, rich sources of exploration and debate, and other teams have been completely lame. So if we believe that the best antidote to bias is, if you like, a diversified portfolio of biases. And if we believe that people together can make wiser, smarter decisions than individuals working alone, how do we create the kinds of teams in which diversity and truth-telling is maximized? That was essentially the basis of the research done at MIT Center for Collective Intelligence. And their research shows us, I think, some really challenging data. The first is this. They brought 500 people in, and they tested them for IQ, and they gave them very hard problems to solve. And they discovered, as you might expect, that there's a rough correlation between IQ and problem solving. But then they put people into teams, and they gave them very high order problems to address together, as many of us do at work. And they measured which teams came up with more answers faster. Of course, they found what we've experienced, right? Which is some teams are great and some are really not so great. The question was, what are the characteristics of the high-performing teams? What was striking to begin with is what the characteristics were not. The best teams were not the teams with the highest aggregate IQ. So the idea that the best team is all the IQ superstars brought together didn't play out. In addition, the best teams were not those with one or two IQ superstars. So this idea that really all you want is kind of sheer brain power wasn't confirmed. Instead, the really high-performing teams had just three characteristics. The first was that they did score very highly on a different test, a test called reading the mind in the eye, which is broadly considered a test for empathy. It's about how connected am I with you, how concerned am I to kind of keep you in the conversation, how much is happening between the members of the team. The second characteristic, when they rewound the recordings of the discussions, was that in the really successful teams, everybody roughly made an equal contribution. So there were no passengers, but equally there were no single dominant voices. Everybody was able to make a contribution. And the third characteristic of the high-achieving teams is that they had more women in them. Now, the researchers themselves don't really know what this means, which is it because women tend to score more highly on the reading the mind in the eye test, so you're doubling down on the empathy quotient? Or is it simply that you get a different perspective, an element of diversity? But what I think is really striking about this research, which interestingly pertains to virtual teams every bit as much as it does to face-to-face teams, is that the key component here is what's happening between people, the interaction between the team members. You could say that what it shows is that what's more important is the mortar rather than the bricks, that the social capital between individuals is what led to the ability to make superior decisions. Now, this is really interesting because what it suggests is that, yes, we could and should be hiring more diverse participants in our organizations. We badly need the different perspectives, life experiences, mindsets, thinking styles that diversity represents. And that isn't just women, although obviously that's a significant component of the problem that we're addressing. But it also suggests that we really need to work on this mortar between people. We need to create environments in which it's really safe to ask hard questions. It's safe to challenge. It's safe to argue. And we need to recognize that when people produce challenging data or perspectives, that the conflict that engenders isn't a threat, it's a gift. Because what it's doing is it's taking us out of the narrow perspective of our biases and allowing us to see more broadly. It's stopping us from being blind. Now, this suggests a lot of things, not just about hiring people, but about how they're treated and the kinds of behaviors that are encouraged. And it made me think back to the organizations that I've run and how high the level of debate was, or could have been. And one of the things it made me recognize was that in the software businesses that I built and ran in the United States, I always had one or two people who knew me very well and knew that I was open for argument and debate, and in a sense, their experience and their behavior taught the others that it was okay. You could ask hard questions. You could present hard challenges. That's what you did here. But I've come to recognize also that's very unusual. Why? Well, it's partly because power structures are intimidating. If you go back to the organizational research, organizational silence research, why are people silent? Fear. Fear of retribution from colleagues or coworkers. In other words, I don't want to be seen to be a troublemaker. I just want to get along. In that silence is all the challenge that could inform our decisions and make them smarter, but that is somehow never brought to the table. Power structures are intimidating, they silence people, and they make them feel that their unique contributions, for which they have typically been hired, may not be wanted. We have educational systems that reward people who come up with the right answer, the implication being that there is only one right answer. Whereas in the real world in which all of us operate, there are multiple answers, and it behooves us to identify, surface, and explore as many of those as possible in order to have the confidence and trust that the decisions we make ultimately are the very best that they could be. It means we have to think very seriously about reward structures and what we are rewarding for. Are we rewarding for being right, for contributing to the process that led to a richer, better-based decision? Or are we rewarding only for results, regardless of how those results were achieved? When I started my work on willful blindness, I was very focused on institutions that had failed. For one thing, they're pretty obvious to see, and for another thing, at the time that I wrote the book, it felt a very urgent problem to understand how it was that organizations so full of smart people had managed to fail so spectacularly. But as I've continued my research and I've gone around the world talking about it, I've come to see that it isn't just institutional failure that's implied with willful blindness. It's also the failure to spot opportunities. So when I was running software companies in the United States, Microsoft very spectacularly missed the internet. On the day that Netscape went public, Microsoft didn't even have a browser in production. Now, it's easy to say, oh, well, that's Microsoft, it was too big to be smart, or some such, you know, kind of lame explanation. But more recently, you can look at a company like Google, widely regarded as one of the smartest companies in the world, and ask, how is it that this company missed social networking? You can be quite sure that at the time that Facebook went live, there were people at Google playing with it. You can be quite sure there were plenty of people thinking this is pretty cool. And nobody put their hand up to say, maybe we should play with this. Maybe we should think about this. A multi-billion dollar error from which Google has not recovered in the sense that they have no viable social networking software of any value. So the challenge here is not just to hire a very diverse workforce, although God knows that's hard enough. The challenge is to create the culture and the environment in which those very diverse people with very diverse experience and very different ways of thinking feel that they are able and rewarded if they speak up and present challenge. And one of the things that I've been very struck by, I study scientists a lot, and I study scientists because they do what entrepreneurs do. They find really hard problems and try to solve them in a competitive environment. And one of the things I've found is that the scientists who make the great breakthroughs, it's not their individual genius that really becomes fundamental. It's that they're working in an environment where challenge, debate, and disagreement are welcomed and supported, where they don't feel that the hard question and the argument is a career-destroying move. They think it's what they're there for. Now, I would argue this has never been more critical than it is now. The reason being that it is harder today to see what's coming than it has ever been before. The doyen of forecasters, Philip Tetlock, argues that for really accurate predictions, the window is now no longer than 2 years. So our ability to think far forward, as all of you have to do, and to see what's changing and what isn't changing, to understand what's happening in the environment out there, is harder than it has been before. There's more data than ever before, and it increases at a rate that is faster than our capacity to handle it. And this is not just me saying this. You know, I've spent time talking to people in the intelligence services, talking to people in the armed forces, and they all say, yeah, it's fantastic. We have all this data. There's too much. We don't know what to look at, and we don't know what it means. And just 2 days ago, I was in Dallas talking to a whole conference of predictive analytics software developers who are desperate for really fierce debate and argument because the data they're presenting is accepted too blindly. They know that data isn't truth. They know that data is a function of the questions that you ask. And yet what they're finding is that their data is often taken too seriously, too much like gospel. And what they're hungry for is debate about what does it mean, what does it show, what else should we be looking at. They're hungry for argument, debate. They recognize that it's through constructive conflict that you can see opportunities and see risks in a way that's far richer and sounder than one or two super smart people working on their own, or even six or eight people violently agreeing. You know the great story of Alfred Sloan at General Motors ending a board meeting saying he wasn't going to make a decision because actually everybody agreed, and he wouldn't make the decision until there was some disagreement. Whenever you have six people in a room agreeing violently, you know that somebody's not thinking or somebody's not speaking up. We hire people who are like us because, of course, they confirm our biases and they confirm our worldview in exactly the same way that we buy the newspapers we agree with, we watch the TV channels that we agree with, and it feels fantastic. And of course, more recently, it's become very fashionable to blame high technology on this. It's Facebook's, you know, filter bubble, or fake news filter bubble. But the truth is that we are all trapped in the narrow perspective of our experience and our upbringing. That places upon us a responsibility to keep updating that, of course, and to keep learning and noticing what's changing in our world. But one person will never know enough, never see enough, never ask enough questions to be able to make the kind of hard calls that you have to make in your business every day. The whole premise of collective intelligence is that together we can see more, we can surface more opportunities, we can miss less with challenge and debate. That's why, you know, Tetlock argues in favor of adversarial tournaments. Because actually it's in the argument that you start to see the edges of possibility. It's in the argument that you give people permission to bring their differences and their experience. And it's in the debate that your own mind grows so that you start to notice new things too. It's no accident, I think, that all of his research at IARPA has shown that the super forecasters, the people who really can see a lot of what's going on, are not experts. They are people of multi-disciplines with open minds who keep challenging themselves. Now, this doesn't mean that expertise doesn't count. Expertise counts, of course. You need deep understanding. What it does mean is that expertise isn't enough, and that expertise acquires over time its own patina of bias. That as we become more expert, first of all, people kowtow to us more, and secondly, we start to challenge ourselves less. And the only real antidote to that is to have people of different expertise and different mindsets and different life experiences who are feel safe enough and feel a high enough degree of trust to ask the hard questions, to bring in the disconfirming data. One of the most extraordinary cases of willful blindness that I wrote about was a very old story, although nobody ever looked at it. It concerned a doctor in Oxford just after the Second World War. And she was a very unusual doctor. She was married, divorced, had kids, which at that time was extremely unusual. She was a very fine scientist, and like all great scientists, she wanted to make her name by discovering something extraordinary. The thing she chose to study was why was there a rising rate of childhood cancers, especially among affluent children. Most disease, of course, is correlated with poverty. She did her research. She researched 500 families with kids who died of cancer and 500 families who didn't have kids who died of cancer. And what she found is that overwhelmingly, the kids who died of cancer had mothers who'd been x-rayed when they were pregnant. Astounding data. She publishes her data. Everybody gets very excited. The National Health in Scotland commissions her to do a similar study. She hurries to do it because she thinks we're going to stop doing this and I'll lose all the learnings. I need to learn everything I can about this phenomenon. She needn't have hurried. It was 25 years before the British medical establishment stopped x-raying pregnant women. People like to explain this brilliant example of willful blindness by saying, well, it's because she was female. I don't think it is, because the American Medical Association did their own research, exactly the same results, and it took them 24 years to stop x-raying pregnant women. So I don't think the gender difference is the crucial thing here, but it did mean she could easily get tuned out. What fascinated me about her story was how did she keep going for 25 years? 25 years on your own battling the British medical establishment is no joke. And I discovered something fascinating, which is she had a thinking partner, a statistician that she worked with named George Neal, as different from her as possible. So she was very gregarious, very sociable. He was quite retiring, really preferred numbers to people. But he once said something fantastic. He said, my job is to prove that she's wrong. Because if I can't, she has the confidence to keep up the debate. I think it's a brilliant model of how we can all do better thinking. to find people who are on side but challenging us. Find people who are not like us, who will see things through a different lens, and who have permission and understanding that when they find different ways of looking at what we're thinking about or what we're planning, and they present the argument that that isn't a threat, it's a gift. The great allure of conformity and bias is that it's really comfortable. It's really simple, and it makes us feel immensely confident. And of course, that's what makes it so dangerous. And the real challenge of diversity is that it's complex, it's about conflict, and it's about disconfirmation. But that is what makes it smart. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Margaret. I particularly like the idea that diverse perspectives help us miss less.
Yeah.
We have time for questions, so do raise your hands and, there are questions. I've got one on my screen, which I'll go with first, which is, are there any lessons to be learned from team sports? And the questioner says that men, tend to have more experience of them than women. Do we need more mixed sports?
Yeah, that's a great question. I mean, as it happens, and trust me, I never believed this would be my life. I've been working recently with both Arsenal football team and Saracens rugby. So I've been thinking about team sports a lot more than I ever thought I would. What's really interesting is, of course, these are both organizations that think very deeply about how all the different pieces work together. I think the experience of team sports is a great experience, and I think it's a shame that it's harder for kids to get this at school. Because I think it is really important. Saracen certainly put their success down to the efforts they make to make the team members really care about each other. So they put a lot of time and money into what they call building bonds and making memories. Mm-hmm. So it's about feeling collective responsibility even while people have individual roles to play. At Arsenal, it's the case is that, you know, the feeling that everyone's a soloist means that under pressure, people do stupid things for themselves, which are unhelpful for the team. So I think whether teams are all male or all female, I think there's a lot to learn in how teams work well. Mixed gender teams, I don't have a problem with, but I think the crucial thing in great teamwork is understanding it's about what's happening between people. That they have to be different, they have to play different positions, obviously. And they need to be able to keep in mind these, if you like, kind of conflicting aims, which is, I need to do my best, but the best has to be best for the whole too. And I think people with a great experience of any kind of team, in sports or anything else, can maintain that tension really productively. And where teams fall apart is when people think it's all about me.
Yeah. Thank you. The question, where are we? Number three up there, Sarah? Yeah.
Hi, thanks for a brilliant presentation. While you were talking, I was sort of scanning my career, almost 20 years, and I have to say I've never come across any firm which takes what you say seriously. Lots of lip service, but never seen it. Have you come across any financial services firms that actually do what you think they should be doing? Without the lip service, I mean, who actually do it?
Yeah, it's a great question. I mean, actually what you often find is there is a lot of conflict, but it's around the wrong stuff, right? Parking. Food, you know, it's all displaced into all those sort of things. I've come across, actually, it's an interesting question. I have to say, I have come across it much more in insurance than in other kinds of financial services. And you probably will understand this better than I do. It seems to me that insurance has a very particular kind of culture. It's quite intellectual in a strange way because it's on this sort of interface between the real world and the numbers. Mm-hmm. And I've definitely come across it there because it's a lot of it is about scenarios. And you know, if you're going to do real scenario thinking, you have to be prepared to accept difficult hypotheses. But beyond that, I think you're absolutely right. I think there is a lot of lip service. I think there are a lot of reward structures that are aimed at soloists, which means that people are only going to speak up if they think they stand to win something. I would also say that many of the most creative companies that I work with or have written about make this very easy. You know, they make it easy both by having more collective reward structures, flatter power structures, and by building the social capital between people so that conflict can be cordial. But I think there is still a huge amount in financial services that isn't about constructive conflict, it's about hand-to-hand combat. And actually that reinforces biases, it makes people really defensive, and that leads to very poor decision making.
Question in the middle there.
Hello, I just wanted to ask, have you considered culture in your research?
Yeah, because, you know, that's always the culprit. I mean, I do think when you're talking about organizational change, you know, there's always the question, do you start with the personal, the individual, or do you start with the organizational? And I think the truth is, you have to do both. It's impossible not to do both. So you can do a lot in terms of the kinds of people that you hire. But you can hire the most diverse workforce in the world and still get alarming degrees of homogeneity if you don't really work this issue of making people feel comfortable in their difference, not making them fit in. Earlier in my career, I wrote very extensively about women's careers. And what became kind of heartbreakingly obvious is that lots of companies would hire women. And then the kind of implicit deal was, you know, we'll let you in as long as you act like us. Well, I mean, that's no sort of advance at all. And typically what happened is that, you know, women would join these firms and either leave quickly because they couldn't stand it, or they would conform. And so the diversity numbers kind of looked a little bit better, but there wasn't any real diversity in the thinking. I think the cultural part is very hard, and I do think you can't do culture change if you aren't prepared to do some really hard work, like looking at, you know, rewards, incentives, hiring practices, and how much investment you're prepared to make in building social capital between people. One thing that's really clear is that to create a climate of safety, you have to build trust. To build trust, you have to keep people for quite a long time. Teams get much better over time. There's a kind of myth out there that what you need to do is keep swapping teams in and out because the risk of groupthink. But actually, the danger of that is you don't build the level of trust that allows people to speak up openly. And what all the research shows is that, you know, you can keep teams for years and maybe add one member every 5 years or so. And the level of trust will deliver more in terms of safety than changing it a lot. And again, you know, if you look at things like intelligence teams, I do a certain amount of work with the intelligence community, it's very clear that the teams that stick together are the teams that really start to see stuff that others cannot.
Am I allowed one more question? I think there's somebody down here that's waiting.
Hi.
It's Sarah, sorry.
Hi Margaret, thanks. Hi. You promised it would be a good chat, and you certainly delivered, so thank you. I do a reasonable amount of recruitment in the non-executive space, which is constantly an uphill struggle in the area of diversity. One, because I find organisations generally just do not commit enough time to doing an appropriate process. But the second is I try and ask people to think, how will they recognise the answer to a question that is coming from someone who thinks very differently from them as a good answer? Mm-hmm. How do we achieve that?
Yeah, it's difficult. I mean, I think there is so much misunderstanding about what non-executive roles require. And the degree to which hard questions and debate have to be what the work product is. And I have to say, having sat on several boards, I have been absolutely flabbergasted by the degree to which that debate does not occur. And I mean, there are some, you know, well-documented examples that I've written about of, you know, disconfirming voices being told, basically, you know, this isn't what you're here for. So I think it needs quite a lot of education about what's the job. You know, what does a good board meeting actually look and sound like? And I think, you know, this Alfred Sloan story, you know, is a great story, which is if there is no disconfirmation, then there are lots of people either not working or not speaking up. Again, I'm thinking about, you know, some of the people I've talked to in the intelligence community. You say, you know, if there is no disconfirming data, you know something's wrong. It shouldn't be the moment at which you think, oh, that's great, now we know exactly what to do. It should be the moment at which you think we either have the wrong people, or we're asking the wrong questions, or we're silencing the wrong people. So I think this has to be explored pretty explicitly. The other thing I'd say on that topic is, you know, people often get very typecast on boards. And there is always a risk that, you know, the female directors will be thought of as the diversity champions, which I think is pretty catastrophic, really, because everybody thinks they're self-interested, and so their contribution is discounted. The best antidote to that I ever came across was a colleague of mine who sat on the board of a Fortune 500 company in the US, who did a trade with one of her board members and said, look, you take diversity, I'll take the environment. Because as long as you had men asking the diversity questions, and you had her asking, you know, hard business questions about environmental impact, you had a better quality of debate. And I think when it comes to diversity, specifically with women, you have got to have men championing this, or you will get nowhere. The best diversity champion I ever encountered was at IBM, made huge strides, African-American male, absolutely understood what discrimination felt like. Everybody took him seriously, and they knew he wasn't self-interested. And I think, you know, we tend to think about diversity, especially after International Women's Day, specifically around gender. But I think we have got to think about it more broadly and recognize that actually each board position needs to be slightly different. And if it isn't, it's, you know, this has nothing to do with political correctness. If it isn't, it's just a business risk.
I think we're going to need to stop there, I'm afraid. Really good place to end, and thank you very much, Margaret. Before I ask you to thank Margaret, can I please remind you, if you haven't, to fill in the privilege survey on your conference app, because it's really important for the theme of this conference, and we're going to give you the results of that on Friday. And can I please ask you to thank Margaret in the usual way.